Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
And tonight we have present all of our commissioners, Commissioner Tim Sutton, Vice Chair Eddie Boswell, Commissioner Bill Lashley, and Commissioner Steve Carter. So, Commissioner Sutton, if you would please lead us in an invocation and the pledge.
Yes, thank you. If we can take a moment, please. My Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us be able to exercise what so pointedly was shown after our 244th birthday, July the 4th, just a week and a half ago, what our founding fathers laid out for us on that day, July the 4th. I'm not sure how many years afterwards. I think it was 50 years after the Declaration, Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, our second and third presidents, respectively, passed away on the same day. 5 years later, James Madison died on July the 4th. It's hard to believe that there wasn't some divine intervention or divine underlines there. There was much sacrifice by our founding fathers to leave us what they left us. When Adams passed away, you know that he said Jefferson survives. Little did he know that Jefferson had passed hours earlier. Help us all to see some moral implications in that we should never take for granted what the status of things are. Help us to live as they would have us live. We all know that Thomas Jefferson and Adams didn't deal with each other for 11 years because of animosities and differences in opinions, so forth and so on, and in the end they wrote letters to each other and had great admiration for each other. Help us to learn how to deal with our adversaries in the way that they did in those days, but not wait 11 years to do so. Anyway, past that point, historically, bless this nation, bless our country, bless our world, our leaders. We have to find ways of peace and proper detente without missiles and guns, and it can be done, but only through the wisdom of man and his and her actions. Please be with us through this hot summer. People are suffering. Please help those that need help. And we may not know them, but you know them, and help us get to that higher plateau as a member of mankind. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Here comes the speaker book. We have a few people signed up to speak tonight. We have three people. I'm not sure if you are speaking about an agenda item or a non-agenda item. We have, and so when I call you, I'll ask you what the nature of your comments are going to be. We have two opportunities for public speaking on our agenda. The first is for items that are related to the agenda itself, and then the second, which is at the end of the meeting, is for people who have other things on their mind, who have an issue or something that they want to bring to the county's attention that is not directly related to an item that's on the agenda for business tonight. I'd ask people who are thinking about coming for the public comment period to please review our rules for public comment. They're posted on our county's website. You're limited to 3 minutes. You're limited to 3 people per topic, pro and con. But I don't think that that's going to be an issue tonight from the number of speakers that we have. So just please review those. Everybody, if you would please check your cell phone and be sure that it's silent, then that would be nice too. So with that being said, Gary Ulickney, you are the first on the list.
Good evening.
Good evening, Gary.
Hello again.
How you doing?
Okay.
Good.
All right. Good evening. My name is Gary Ulickney, and I reside in Snow Camp, North Carolina. I'm here tonight to talk about the Alamance County Noise Ordinance proposed revision. As you will hear from other speakers in more detail, our county is one of only two in the state without zoning that exempt heavy industry from their noise ordinance. Mm-hmm. Others have noise restrictions and some have hours of operation restrictions on industry noise. This means that in Alamance and Macon counties, you cannot play your radio too loud, but a company is able to blast, crush rock, have a constant flow of truck traffic 24 hours a day with no citizen recourse. I'm reminded of a recent presentation by our planning director when she put up a slide showing the counties in North Carolina that had zoning. With the exception of a very few rural and poor eastern and western counties, Alamance was the only county in the Piedmont region without some type of zoning. I ask you, the county commissioners, in a county that's located in the fastest growing part of our state, are you content with constantly being the exception and years behind where our neighboring counties are? In addition to looking at other counties, shouldn't common sense be a factor, as you've had mothers with young children speak to you about their concerns regarding mining noise at all hours? I remember sitting in this room and hearing Ms. Gailey propose a motion to remove the heavy industry exemption from the noise ordinance, and I believe that motion would have passed. However, our county attorney jumped up and argued that you couldn't do that in a county that doesn't have zoning, which we believe is not true, as you will hear. Because our ordinance are poorly designed and lax is exactly the reason that Alamance Aggregates chose to locate in Alamance County, a place where a county permit could be approved with no citizen input and no concern for environmental and land rights of the affected citizens. You have a chance tonight to move the county forward by approving a noise ordinance that protects the peace and tranquility of its citizens. We wholeheartedly support removing the exemption for heavy industry and placing reasonable hours of operation on high noise industries. Finally, we as a community have become increasingly frustrated with our county attorney, who appears to have a vested interest in assuring
Dr. Ulickney, I'm going to stop you there because we do have a part in our public comment that we don't single out employees. If you have issues with any county employee, if you would please.
I will turn this in then to Tori and you can read it, okay?
That'd be fine. Okay, next
up. I gave you the wrong copy.
Sorry. Next on the list would be Bill Hussey.
My name is Bill Hussey. I'm a property owner here in Alamance County, and this is regarding the noise ordinance as well. At the May 6th commissioners meeting, Mr. Albright stated or suggested that the reason our surrounding counties do not contain the industry exemption is that we do not have zoning. I believe the exact words were one of our speakers this morning, the gentleman from Snow Camp, and I do appreciate that. Compliment, even though I'm not sure my name and gentleman are always there together, indicated that five surrounding counties don't have these problems. Well, they have zoning, Guilford, Orange, Randolph, and that's how they deal with this issue. In researching the 16 counties in North Carolina that do not have zoning, we have found that eight counties, including Alamance, with a noise ordinance, six of them with no exemption for the industry. No zoning, no exemption. Eight counties do not have noise ordinance of any sort. Only one other county, Macon County in the West, in addition to Alamance, has the industry exemption. So clearly zoning is not something that directly relates to the exemption with the county noise ordinance. I don't know why I'm having trouble with that tonight. At that same meeting, Ms. Gailey, you stated, can we break out of the class four uses under the heavy industrial development ordinance and subject those to a time limit under the noise ordinance? When we talked about that, or when y'all talked about that at the meeting, there was some time spent discussing it and the exemption under Section 7, number 14. Normal sounds associated with or customary to industry or industrial or manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, provided that said business are operating in a lawful manner. There's been some time spent talking about that, and I guess the question is, can or could we pull out those businesses that are permitted under the Class 4 uses of the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance and put the same kind of time restriction or the time restrictions that we've discussed before in place to look at what we do to manage that? According to the North Carolina General Statute 153A133, noise regulation, a county may, by ordinance, regulate, restrict, or prohibit the production of emissions of noise or amplified speech, music, or other sounds that tend to annoy, disturb, or frighten its citizens. Nothing is restrictive in this language in regards to zoning as it relates to an industry exemption, nor does it preclude applying time or time limits. Members of the Snow Camp community have voiced their concern to you repeatedly regarding this unfair exemption. I'll try to do as quickly as I can. And over 500 citizens have signed a petition to support the removal of the industry exemption for the noise ordinance. We just ask that you, as you go back to that May 6th meeting, that we look at the vote that was being considered at that point, and please remove the industry exemption from the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ozzie. Okay, next is Julie Lee Schott, but I saw on the agenda that Julie Lee Schott had signed up for the end of the meeting, and so I'm going to call that name at that time. I don't see anybody stepping forth right now. And then Donna Pope.
I'll see you again.
Okay, great. Make a note. And David Sharp?
Sheep.
Sheep.
Sheep. I'll speak
Sheep. Sheep. S-H-O-O-P. Thank you. And then Thomas Griffin, I think, has signed up to speak about the land development update. So that's definitely an agenda item. Hello, Mr. Griffin. Welcome.
How are y'all?
We're good. Glad to see you.
I ain't never been here, but I'm going to say what I've got to say, and I'll be gone.
Yes, sir.
Noah's ordinance and people shooting guns don't much care about it, as long as they own their own place. Don't much care about the land. I back up to 1,000 acres. I live less than a mile, half a mile from Snow Camp Mountain. I've known about it for 2 years when they're taking soil samples. So some of them will tell you this and that. Now, most of them transplants that moved in there, same ones don't want a cow ball and this and that or a chicken house. Now, I'm going to leave it at that. Y'all decide what you want. Oh, one more thing. I don't see why I need $138,000 money spent for somebody to tell me what to do with my land down there.
Thank
All
you.
I got to say.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
The time.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin, for coming out. We appreciate hearing from you. Okay. Do we have any commissioner responses?
I guess we'll discuss them when we get to the agenda item, right?
Yep. Can do that. All right. Next is approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
OK. Okay, we have a motion and a second for approval of tonight's agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, we move on to the consent agenda. If everybody has had opportunity to review the items on the consent agenda, if no one has any motions to make regarding those items to be moved, he's seeking a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. Next, we have the land development plan update regarding the consultant.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
Time short.
Good evening.
There we go. Okay, so I'm going to be brief. You all can ask me questions. You all have the proposal from Stewart. Stewart is the company that was picked by the committee of county directors. It's what sat on the committee. It was four of us. We got three responses from our RFP for the land development plan. We interviewed two. Of those two, Stewart was the one that the committee agreed upon, so we moved forward with that. June 7th was when we did interviews with them, and then we got the draft contract that's before you all tonight. What I will kind of all these pages, what is some of the most important for us to look at tonight? Of course, the pricing is in the back. The total for the contract, if all pieces are assumed to be part of it, is $138,500. There's a $7,000 option, which is this board's decision on whether to opt for it or not. The State of the County Summit, and that is on page 82 of your packet. It discusses having a specific meeting for State of the County Summit. The summit, led by Stewart team member Economic Leadership, which is a subcontractor of Stewart, could feature speakers to provide an overview of land use and market trends in the county, cost of services data, and ongoing potential future economic development. The event would be open to the public. However, invitations could be targeted at elected officials, board members, business owners, and other key stakeholders and spur engagement early in the process of the land development plan. Now, land development plans all certainly have an economic development piece. It's terribly important to know where you want your growth areas to be and what type of growth you want in certain areas of the county. That's already going to be covered in the plan. This is just a totally separate task piece that would pull members of the community together specifically for that piece of the plan. So that's the option tonight, including, of course, the whole plan itself. But that's a separate piece should the commissioners choose to do that. That's a $7,000 price. Of course, we take that out, and we're down to $131,500. I don't know what questions you all have for us. I do have a representative here from Stewart to have questions about the company itself.
One of the things I noticed when I was reading through the package was that it says meetings with the planning board or commissioners, original meeting with the planning board or commissioners. I don't know how the rest of the commissioners feel about that, but I think we definitely
want
to be there.
We want to be that.
We want to be an or.
Yeah.
Sure. That's going to, well, it kind of calls for both throughout the process. Certainly
right.
It ends with commissioners, but it doesn't only talk to commissioners at that point. It allows us to do what we need to do. It gives a little massage room of who we need to bring it to, or we're going to have to bring pieces anyway as we go. It's not a one and done kind of thing. So it depends on how commissioners will want to handle it. It gives us enough massage room where if commissioners want to hear from us 1 month, that planning board will hear from regularly as well. But if you want to update, we all come and we do the update, and that's covered in the cost.
How frequently will Stewart be updating us?
Stewart will be updating staff on a monthly basis. Staff can come here at any time. Stewart, I believe, has about three meetings in there, including two at the very, very, in addition, two at the very, very end that would be kind of a review meeting and then maybe an approval meeting after comment kind of thing to make sure we've got it all covered. But a lot of public engagement, that was an important part that we had heard many times. We've got plenty of public engagement in here. They have some great tools to help us. They have Community Viz, which is a really new tool. County staff has just been exposed to it probably a few weeks ago. And it works through GIS, but it gives kind of a projected growth areas based on population and things like that that they work from. And it kind of show us where our burst of growth will look in 10, 15, 20 years out. And that way that'll help us do a plan that would kind of guide in those directions. Given good data, you get good results. So.
I just definitely want to be, I don't think any of us want to be back where we were last year.
No, that's true.
We don't want any surprises.
That's definitely set up that way where this is not a, like I said, keep you in the dark to the very, very end. That's not the plan. And I'm sure you all probably get a fair amount of questions about what is, how is, what is going on.
Yeah, you can count on it.
So, when's the last time we did a land development plan?
What was it, 07 when we did the official, but the numbers were from 05.
So that's 14 years old numbers.
And, you know, in it you've got transportation plans and you're using tax data for land use, which is a very narrow data point for planning. We're a whole lot longer list of what land use is. So hopefully this is in hopes to grab more of that, talk to communities and get a feel for not just what a computer says, but what's actually there.
We just had a comment made by a citizen about not wanting anybody to tell him what to do with his land.
And I understand.
I know that county citizens are very sensitive about that issue and always have been. But at the same time, we have an issue going on right now with in Snow Camp where nobody wanted to be where they are. So we definitely have to find some sort of a happy medium between nothing and something.
Hopefully, you know, the land development plan is a comprehensive plan. It's not made to be each parcel kind of evaluation. That's what the smaller area plans are for. So hopefully the land development plan will guide us into what we feel like is a good next step after that. And but that, at least give us somewhere to go.
And the idea is that the steps that follow from the land development plan would have the input of the people in the township or the proximate area that we're talking about. It wouldn't be somebody from the county office dictating to people what is right and what's wrong for that community. Could be that community deciding it for themselves.
That's right. For the small area plan, you want the people of the area to come out and be a part of the committee to help write.
Absolutely.
What makes sense there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, people need to come out to those meetings and let us hear what you think.
Right. This process doesn't work if you don't get the public involved. And we can open meetings all day long, but if people don't show up, we still get the same results.
Yeah.
I'm sorry I didn't ask this ahead of time so people could prepare, but does anybody have an offhand guess at what the change in population is from 2005 to 2019? That's
not off the top of my head, but I think we've got some internet connections here. We might can do a little quick research to see if we can find that out as we continue to talk about it. So from 2005 to 2015, the growth of the county, the how many folks,
or even from 2010, that's the last time the census was done.
Well, between 2002 and now, it's about 40,000
added
to, and now we're at about 160,000.
163,000 now. Yeah,
so that sounds, I was thinking it was 135,000 around in 2010.
We're looking in the audit. I believe that Susan indicated that information is in there, so we'll have it for you in just a moment.
Who's the agency in Raleigh? Where is the school individual?
He left. Jeremy.
He left. Years ago, the school system hired a group that was sanctioned by the state legislature. And they came in here and did a study. And they were off by more than 4,000 students as far as what they said we would have 2017. They said that we would have X amount of students in our system 2017. They were off, like I say, 4,000 short. I mean, over. They were over. And I called down to the guy of the company that did it, and he said, well, we just overestimated and so forth and so on, and they did addendums to that report. They amended it, and they've come out and said, and not saying I support it, but they came out and said that in the year 2022, 5 years later, that we would have less students in our school system than we've got today. And, you know, if you do look at the stats that Your school system demographically has not grown in 10 years. If you know, charter and home, online and home and all that, so I'm not knocking that. I'm just saying that this agency looks at infrastructure, roads and things that they're projecting that the future will hold for us. And I can't think of the name of the group.
I know the group you're talking about. I think we use some of their data as we continue to try to project what developments will produce for Alamance County. So I think we're using some of the original numbers. And they came back and updated, but I just don't remember the year.
Yeah, and they're heavily regarded. Yes. And the state legislature did approve it. And how much of this is going to be tied to the prospects of roads coming in here? I mean, you can't develop land without roads.
Right, there's always a transportation piece. And we really get that from the Burlington Graham MPO. They kind of house and hold kind of the big picture of transportation. Of course, DOT will be involved too. The plan is to reach out to the school system, to transportation, to touch all the pieces that we feel like need to be touched, or find out later need to be touched, so that we get a complete picture here and we don't leave something out that made sense to put in.
See, I've heard for years, or decades really, that the best potential for development in this county is along the Northern Outfall, which flows, are you familiar with the Northern Outfall? Yeah, and but you don't have any roads up there. You know, so it's kind of hard to develop along the outfall if you don't have
a lot of bad sewer situation.
Yeah. Well, the outfall was taken care of.
Yeah, if you ever got that up there.
So, I think everything we do in this county as far as where we want to develop, how much bridled growth, too, not unbridled growth. Unbridled growth is killing a lot of these communities. You can't even drain water quick enough. Flash floods in Greensboro, it's because the water has nowhere to go. No matter how good they do it, the roads are flooding like crazy. And so anyway, bridle growth is something I'm interested in, but definitely linked to road development. You know, you got roads have to go in my opinion, first somehow, and try to find out, you know, who's going to build roads, when, what's the state projections. I mean, we had a chance to build an inner loop in Burlington. What's the name of the part they did build over by Williams High School?
Huh?
Rockwood.
Rockwood, yeah.
And they're extending that through to Glen Raven.
But Graham.
But they never did.
Yeah.
Well, it's on the books now.
Yeah, but I hope they do it.
Graham voted down their part of what would have been the loop. Yeah. And, you know, it's.
Southern Loop, yeah.
Well, what was it? Going to come through Graham and hook over by Graham Hopedale Road and then hook around to.
The Southern Loop.
Yeah, so. I hope we can get some good commentary out of that.
I hope we'll get good
commentary. I'm rambling, but. I'm kind of in a rambling mood tonight.
Well, have you got the staff to? I mean, this is going to put a lot on the planning.
Gave me a lot. You gave me a whole position, which we have the job description ready and this close to getting that thing out. That would be terrific to get somebody else in here. I don't plan on giving this project up. I actually plan on keeping my hands in and not giving it to a new person. There's other things that are maybe simpler, easier to take on quickly. This, not so much. But all of our staff are going to have to be involved, especially when we start doing the public meetings and things. And taking public comment, I'm sure we'll come into our office and keeping tabs of all that, too.
And the 7,000 option part, explain that a little better, please.
That's what Chad's here for. He's going to come up here and explain to you what traditionally
they have done. If he wants 7,000, he's going to have to talk.
That's right. He's going to have to talk here for 7,000.
As we change speakers, the numbers from 2010, the population was a little over 148,000, and the audit has the population in 2018 as being a little over 163,000. So it was about a 15,000 person increase, roughly 10% in that time period. So significant growth for the state of North Carolina.
Yeah.
So, thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
All right. So, well, first of all, let me introduce myself. I'm Chad Serry, and I'm with Stewart. A little bit about our firm. We're a 25-year-old firm. We're all located in Raleigh, Durham, Charlotte, and Wilmington, and we work on land use plans like this all across the state, in counties and municipalities, and so we're very happy to be here, excited to be here, and we really appreciate this opportunity. Regarding the additional service, our partner, Economic Development, when we do partner with them, they provide almost an extra level of economic development, a localized summit, so to speak. That's open to the public, that provides sort of a perspective of your county at more of a local level. Your plan, as Tanya mentioned, you'll have an economic development component to it. This sort of takes it to an extra level. Without having those experts here, that's about as best I can explain it to you. So it would be, again, it's just an extra step towards economic development in the county that provides a very localized, specific meeting just towards that, where your overall land use plan will have different components to different meetings, you know, transportation, open space, land use, things of that nature. And this would be solely for economic development.
And I thought we have the chamber to help us with that. So, what
chamber plays a role. This is kind of economic development 10 years down the road.
Yeah, forecast.
And the chamber will forecast. Be involved no matter what. This just will pull chamber and anybody else that they would think of or we would think of that could be a party and see their goals and their plans and how mm-hmm. that would work into our plan. Okay. So that's a piece I asked to be pulled out because I thought that would be a piece y'all would like to discuss.
And what experiences your company had with counties that had no zoning at all?
We actually have had quite a bit, believe it or not. Okay. There are not a lot of counties left that don't have
that's
zoning.
That's why I asked.
We've worked in Granville County. They have sections that are not zoned. We actually worked and are still working in Jackson County in the mountains. I think there may be five counties that might be left. So we've done two of them. Now we're working with three. So we've got a pretty good percentage there.
Okay, well, they work in Chatham County.
And Chatham County also, yeah. Yeah,
we're also working by another state.
What's that?
We're going to run out.
We're also working in Guilford County also. So we've kind of got it surrounded right. here in Alamance.
I guess you come behind when they have zoning to re-look at their situation.
With your land use plan and your kind of a comprehensive plan, it's kind of a big picture item, right? So it's kind of how you want to be 10, 15, 20 years down the road. And you brought up a good point. Your existing land use plan is 2007. Typically, you want to relook at your comprehensive plan every 5 years. So y'all are almost double past that
yeah.
date. So it's a good time to go through that. But a lot of times we will work with the comprehensive plans, which are the big picture items, the goals and the strategies. And then we also work on ordinance development. So UDOs and zoning ordinances, subdivision ordinances, to take those kind of goals that come out of that into ordinances. So yeah, we work in that okay. capacity all across the state.
Very good.
Thank you. Any more questions at all, Frank?
I'm good.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'm gonna ask the same thing. Any questions at all for me?
I was just gonna make a little comment that you were mentioning that you were going to be very active with this project and having the new person coming on, serving on the planning board as the commissioner representative. I know that I believe that the eventual Hydo heavy industrial revision, ordinance revision, is going to be pretty complex and have a lot more factors and take a lot more staff time in making sure that somebody applying for a permit is in compliance with the permitting process. And so I think that would be a good thing for that new person to be working
on. Oh, I have a whole list. Yeah, absolutely. There's just so much that y'all can imagine. I come in with 10, 15 things to do. I get one done because even today it's crazy Monday. So you go all over the place all day long and then, I still have so much to do. But hopefully that list will shorten when I have an extra.
Well, you've got a good support manager.
Absolutely. Yep. Yeah.
We've had a lot of planning issues over the past
I bet so.
Years.
And since we're talking about road developments and stuff, Commissioner Boswell, I think you're the board representative mm-hmm. on the MPO. Do you happen to know anything about the Highway 49 sort of bypass around Belmont that's been on the books? Do you know if there's anything
that, but I can look out, I can get it, figure it out.
I just didn't know if that was still buried under the sand or if it had sifted
they're
up.
Too worried about Alamance Road widening it when they get to the end of it.
I guess that's true. That's a really big project. I believe that there is on the books a plan to do a bypass around Belmont coming up 49, and that's going to change the southern part of the county dramatically. Because that's a artery straight to the super site in Randolph County.
I didn't see that on the list this year either,
no,
so I'll have to find out what they're doing with
there.
That.
I don't think it's on the list of things that's imminent.
If it's not on the spot list, then it's probably not in the works. Then.
Well, we're just off Alamance Road. We were told when we bought over there that there was a plan to extend University, which becomes Grand Oaks as you come into up to Alamance, at the intersection with Alamance Road over to Tucker through that area. And
that's not really
what I've heard,
anything
that's
died that either.
Slow death.
Yeah. It's funds. They got to have money to
that's
make
right.
that happen.
These things are so expensive. They really are. But so critical and important.
So we're going to talk just a little bit about funding and the funding actions that are
sure.
needed for this
yeah.
plan. What I would recommend is if the board is interested in pursuing the land use development plan update, I'd recommend that the board approve taking the $138,500 from unassigned fund balance. Just to let the board know, our conservative estimate of what unassigned fund balance will be for fiscal year ending 18-19 is about $12 million. We won't know that exact dollar amount until the books are closed, and that'll be sometime in September. So right now, our conservative estimate for the balance of unassigned fund balance is about $12 million. And, you know, unassigned fund balance, I will tell you, we will see it go down a little bit at 18-19 primarily because we've done these reimbursement resolutions with the school system and the community college, but we will be recovering those funds in 19-20. So, bottom line, I think what the board has to do, if you want to enter into this contract, you have to approve the contract that was in the packet tonight. That would give me the authority to sign that contract. And you also have a budget amendment in the packet with the proposal that needs to be approved. So there's actually two votes if you're interested in pursuing the plan. One is the budget amendment to allocate the funds from unassigned fund balance, and the other is to approve the contract.
Now, the firm he represents, is it based in, where is it based out of again?
Raleigh.
No,
Raleigh.
You're specifically Raleigh.
Yeah, are you familiar with that group I was referring to?
I am not.
Really?
I think we may have had their website pulled up. Andrew, do you still have that pulled up?
There's an institute with NC State.
That's it?
That's it. So
that's it, yeah.
We had their name. It's Institute for Public Research, I think is what it's called.
You familiar with that?
Yes.
Yeah, that was who I was referring to.
Yeah, I got you. Yeah, once all you right. mention that name, I know exactly
who. I just couldn't remember officially. That. Do you go in and use anything there as a variable for
we,
what y'all research?
We have a lot of different sources from the data that we get. Census agencies such as that. You know, and one thing I failed to mention before is y'all mentioned kind of public involvement. This plan can't be successful without that. So there'll be a lot of, you know, if you had a chance to look through this, there'll be a lot of different avenues for people to participate, you know, whether it's through a website, through in person, through community meetings, you know, through community events. So it can't be successful. You know, the saying goes, if you're not planning, you're planning to fail.
Right.
And, you know, this is true, very true for this case. So there will be a lot of opportunities for the public to come out and have input into this. Just wouldn't be successful without it. But, yes, we'll be pulling data from a lot of different sources. That's the Census Bureau, the state. So there'll be a lot of different sources.
Okay.
From localized area as well, because sometimes the localized information is better than some of the state or national information that we get.
You mentioned a
can
number of hurdle right? meetings. I noticed
yep.
to me.
We're looking at the incorporated communities in the county. Are you planning a public meeting for each one of those or in?
No, the way we would have a series of stakeholder interviews where they would be involved with those. So we would have various folks from the community that we would kind of extract information and find out, information that's relevant to this process. There would be cooperation with each one of those municipalities throughout this process. Mainly this is dealing with this, with the county itself and not those agencies. But there would be some opportunities along the road to include them and provide the information or try to extract some information when it might be relevant to the plan production.
And the unincorporated communities are within the county?
Yes, right. They would be very much involved in this, yes.
And you're looking at about 12 months to go through
we would
this
hope to,
process?
We would hope to have it in a 12-month process, yes, barring some something. Typically, this process is about 11 to 12-month process, yeah. And as far as your involvement with planning board,
we would certainly have a steering committee that would be maybe representatives of the board and planning board, and there would be a lot of opportunity for, you know, plenty of people to be involved in the process. This will not be something that's done behind closed doors at all.
Very good.
Yeah. It can't be. Any more questions?
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
With the steering committee, I generally have an odd number, but a large number, so that, you know, steering committees are volunteers, just like a lot of other boards. But if groups can't be there, it doesn't kill a meeting if we lose some people. So I'm looking for a number, maybe around 13. I definitely have some planning board representation. We need like an engineering piece, a real estate piece, a little bit of mix up of diverse backgrounds. We already have the farm preservation piece. He's just waiting and ready to go. So we're taking anything a board person could send to us, or we can reach out to people that we know of in the community. But I want a pretty substantial group to have good conversation, because yes, we are out and going to be out in the public, but these guys and girls are going to be the ones steering this whole thing. So we want to have a good group.
So I guess we're waiting. If anybody wants to make a motion to, I guess we need to, if somebody wants to make a motion, we would do a budget amendment first, said?
Probably do the contract first, because it may or may not include 7,000.
Okay, approve the contract first, and whether or not we want to.
Explain again what we get for the extra $7,000.
It's a totally economic development focus, bringing together the stakeholders in our county and anybody that would be influential in our county to find out what kind of growth they're looking to do in the future. To, you know, if they're going to throw something large out on the north side of the county and we don't know about it, well, we certainly aren't going to make a good plan if we don't know.
These are people that are in corporations that are looking to expand in the next 10, 15 years.
Yeah, you know, we've got some pretty good players in either the municipalities and just outside in the county. You know, we've got the university that's going to obviously grow too, the community college, which we're already going to be in touch a little bit with them, but pulling them all together to think all at once usually gives us some different results.
I guess I'm kind of curious why that wasn't a part of the original package.
It was. I pulled it out specifically because it was something unusual that I felt like y'all needed to discuss.
More of an option type situation.
Now, we are on two county lines. Well, more, but,
well, we
you
got
know,
a few more than we'll
you got Mebane, you got Elon, you got people going in other counties with their development and so forth, more so in Mebane than, I guess, are we going to look at trying to coincide a little bit of what we're doing, want to do here with what they're doing?
Absolutely. I know Mebane's got a growth plan going on, and they're looking at making some changes for their reasonable future, five-year future. So we definitely need to know what their plans are for growth and everybody else, because if we're planning for something they are too, that's not going to make sense.
Yeah.
You know, the package talked about communicating with the surrounding counties.
Cities, counties, everything, which the county lines are going to change, but at least we know if they've got some big thing coming up and we're in the dark.
So you'd be checking in to see what they had on their planning board also.
And reaching across to their economic development people as well.
What's the total cap figure again?
138.5 if you want to spend it all, or 131.5 if you want to cut out the State of Community Summit.
Well, I think the economic piece is an integral piece of this package.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's time we move forward. We've been sitting.
I'll make a
thumbs.
Motion that we approve the contract with a $7,000 addition.
I'll second that.
Yeah.
Okay. We have a motion and a second to approve the contract with Stewart Group for $138,500. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, and then the budget amendment, we will need a motion to...
We would be allocating $138,500 from unassigned fund balance to the planning department's budget to pay for this plan.
I'll make a motion that we approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you, Tanya.
Thank you so much, Tanya. All right, Mr. Albright, noise ordinance.
Yes, we want to continue with our discussion from the May meeting. But before we do, I'd like to give you an update on Senate Bill 315. That is the North Carolina Farm Act that is moving its way through the General Assembly, which adds hunting, fishing, shooting sports, and equestrian activities to the definition of agrotourism, and will probably end up limiting the ability of county boards to control those things.
Such as shooting ranges and...
Shooting range, hunting, fishing, and equestrian activities. You didn't hear it?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
I'm sorry. Senate Bill 315 limits, if it passes, it's enacted into law, it limits the county's ability to regulate hunting, fishing, shooting sports, and equestrian activities.
Thank goodness.
Well, thought I'd bring it to your attention. And secondly, the ordinance itself, I want to remind the board again that it is supposed to regulate unreasonably loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noises. I had a complaint from a citizen, I think the sheriff may remember this, about a propane cannon going off in an orchard to keep the birds away. About every 15, 20 seconds, kaboom. And the people that moved in beside it were very upset because of what is that noise? Because the trees were blossoming and the fruit was beginning to form. So that's the type of activity that is reasonable if you are an orchard person. And it's those type of things that you need to be mindful of when you're addressing the ordinance. Now, I sent you a copy of it with the changes in red. And we had taken out, we'd added the word unreasonable noise to the purpose of the ordinance. And took out the time periods that we had in there from 10 to 7, was in section 6A. And on the second page, took out the time of day and the specific time of days on the weekends and on weekdays. Removed the repeated firing of weapons from 10 to 7. Remove that section 15. We added bona fide hunting activity to the exceptions and removed shooting ranges from the exceptions, but I think the state General Assembly is going to put that back in. So that's not going to be able to be regulated if that law passes, Senate 315 passes. Then in the penalty section 9, we spelled out that the penalties will not be more than $500 and it'll be a class 3 misdemeanor if a person violates the ordinance. We also added an initial written warning. I sent this to the sheriff and I didn't get a chance to talk to him because he's been on vacation. He and I, we've been real busy. I haven't talked to him about the penalty section, but that was discussed at our meeting in May. So if you want to make any other changes, I'd be glad to discuss them with you. I still don't think it's a good idea to regulate land with a noise ordinance. And you've just approved a contract for a comprehensive land study, and maybe that's the place you should set out standards and decide where you're going to have heavy industry and where you're going to have farms and where you're going to protect residential property. That may be the place to do it.
My question for the sheriff is, does it give you the kind of teeth you were looking for in the ordinance to help you do the job?
Yes, sir. It gives us more teeth than what we had, I can tell you that.
Does it give you enough teeth?
I think so. I think so.
One good thing about being a lawmaking organization is you can change the law within certain parameters, mindful of people's constitutional rights. And you heard from a gentleman today that doesn't want his rights touched. So it's a balance. Mm-hmm.
That's why we've not done zoning.
Right.
Should we leave the shooting range in here or out?
Well, we took it out of this draft ordinance. I don't know whether this Senate Bill 315 will make it into law or if that provision of it will make it into law.
Well, I think there was another statute in Chapter 12. I can't recall. I went back and watched the meeting from April where we had people come and talking about this issue. And there's a statute saying that you can't use noise ordinances to regulate shooting ranges.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it begs the question, what is a shooting range? How do you define that? But
I honestly didn't remember us taking out or saying that we wanted to take out an exemption for shooting ranges, gun clubs.
It was in my notes, but we can certainly put it back in if that's your desire.
We talked about it, yeah.
We did. I think because, well, I can't obviously speak for everybody, but my thinking was that the state statutes prohibit using a noise ordinance to regulate shooting ranges.
Okay.
I appreciate, I believe it was Mr. Hussey brought back up again about the Class 4 uses, and I continue to struggle with that. I continue to struggle with the idea that people can't play their radios or stereos and bother their neighbors between 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. Sunday through Thursday, or 12 a.m. and 6 a.m. Friday and Saturday, but we have an exemption for heavy industry.
Mm-hmm.
And I think my personal opinion is that we could consider defined under on page 2 where we have the following acts among others are declared to be loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noises that we could include noise from industry permitted under the Class 4 of the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance, that they can't be loud between the same hours as the radios and stereos. I noticed that there's another time exemption or deeming to be disturbing and unnecessary. Number 7, building operations, that is longer hours than it is for radios and stereos. That one, number 7, is from 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. Any day or in any district other than a residential area between the hours of 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. So there's a little...
Section 7.
Yeah, on page 2.
Okay. We don't have any indication from Alamance Aggregates as to what their planned hours of operation are, right?
I believe, but I'm not certain, that they said that they would be operating 24 hours. If I recall,
that was part of permitting.
From we might get the planning director back in here, but that was put on their permit that they anticipated operating 24 hours, which I mean, I think that's unreasonable.
I think it's unreasonable too.
Well, I guess I would think there probably would be aspects of their operation which they might not have to do at night. Obviously, they don't have to do blasting in the middle of the night, but.
Tanya, do you recall what they said about their hours anticipated?
I don't have anything great to put in from their application about their operation hours. It says they'll comply with the county, whatever that means.
Okay. And, do you happen to remember offhand? Sorry. Class 4, what is that? That's the mining.
There's asphalt plants, there's mining. There's another one. I think landfills. There's only 3 or 4 in there. That should be most of them.
Is that an industry classification?
In the heavy industrial development, yeah. And I believe it's landfills excluding inert debris, because inert debris is a class 1.
Well, that's in the ordinance that's being proposed. The high dose.
Right. That's in the current ordinance. I don't want to talk about the new one. We've got a lot going on with that, so I can't nail that. It's running around. I can't change it very well. It's running around. They're doing field trips this next week.
That's a good way of expressing that. It is running around.
It's running everywhere, man. I can't give up any room.
It's running hard. People are really working hard on that.
Well, I agree with you, Amy. I think there needs to be something in here some way to provide some relief from continuous 24-hour day noise.
If we put it in there, it'll be in there. Let's put it in. Give us a time.
Well,
what do you think, Clyde?
Well, when you're talking about continuous noise, I think you'll have to differentiate between the night watchman driving his truck in
noise.
And a blast going off. I mean, I think you can regulate when somebody can blast. But
well, you look at the language for number two, radio, stereos, etc. So it defines that as the hour so as to annoy or disturb the quiet comfort or repose of any person of normal sensibilities.
Right.
In any dwelling, motel, hotel, or other type of residence. And these facilities, well, that's another thing with HIDO considerations is whether or not it's going to continue to have the 2,000 feet from the center of operations limit, or is it going to go to a setback from the boundary of the property?
Mm-hmm.
So that's a little quirk there. But knowing that as the ordinance is now, any residence is 2,000 feet away from the center of operations, if somebody in their house is, you know, annoyed and disturbed.
Let me suggest to you that we maybe tie that in to this.
Beg your pardon?
Tie that in just by specific reference to the HIDO ordinance.
Put a phrase about since, the HIDO and
right.
put a time.
We just add another number to that and saying, or noise that is deemed unreasonable by the heavy industry development ordinance.
Right.
Because that's still in the state of flux right now. If you want to put that in here.
I don't think that there's going to be a noise element to the HIDO. I'm talking about setback requirements. I'm talking about land spacing.
Right.
I think that for the noise ordinance to reflect back to the HIDO, to look there for noise regulation is not really optimal as much as maybe looking back for the definition of a class four industry. The asphalt plants and the mining. So we wouldn't be worrying about Buckner steel or galvanized metal, things like that. We'd be worrying about, concerned about the noise from these heavy industries.
Yeah. Well, let me take a shot at it. I'm a little confused about how that would work.
You can separate them out because.
Yeah, because I don't know many quarries that are open at night with people hauling gravel and asphalt. Most of that paving is done during the day.
Martin
and you
Marietta
can't
normally close.
You can't take an asphalt truck out in the middle of the night and pave a road unless you're, I guess you could if you're working on a highway 85 or 40 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But
well, the asphalt plant does on up and down at night.
Yeah.
Well, the most important thing is to address the concerns of the community where they have these plants coming in,
mm-hmm.
where they have to live with it, and these people are concerned about.
Well, would that be covered? Well, where'd Tanya go? There you are. Is that covered in the operational permit? That's the second step of this process, right?
Operational permit only gives me the power to say you had a site plan, you built to the site plan, thank you, and give them a permit.
Okay.
I have nothing else I can say to them.
All right. So they have freedom to run their business
as they
see fit.
Originally.
All right.
But we really don't know what their plans were, right?
I might could dig through some email somewhere, but as it wasn't asked in the application, that's not part of the application, was a noise, so it really isn't addressed in the
application. That's not where we can find out. We can ask them that question.
We can certainly ask them, but as the documentation that we require doesn't require that.
Hey, but things should be on the application. The time they're going to operate should be on the application.
It should be something.
I don't think it's fair if we don't regulate it, because we know they say they're going to be. How well can we hold them to that, though?
Well, one thing is that if the revisions of the ordinance come through the way that the drafts that I've seen, it includes that there has to be presentations to the community. The company applying for the permit has to go to the community, would have to go to the community and
that has been discussed.
And have a public,
tell them what's going on.
Yeah, a public hearing, tell them what's going on.
Well, have them a little personal meeting
so that
the people
can
ask.
Around.
Right.
So they can ask that question and
We can find out more a lot of times at those meetings as well.
Have we not heard anything from the asphalt people? I mean,
the asphalt people?
The ones that are setting up the aggregate plant or whatever, all this.
I've heard that there's a connection, but I haven't talked to anybody representing the asphalt plant. I talked to the aggregates attorney. Got a letter from the Snow Camp mine attorney, anti-mine attorney. But haven't discussed anything about an asphalt plant with anybody.
He's the one that goes to rock.
Right. They go together hand in hand. I understand that.
My question or recommendation, I guess, would be that under the Section 6, Subsection A, the following acts, among others, are declared to be loud, disturbing, and unnecessary noises in violation of this section. Add in there for industry permitted under Class 4 of the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance, and then have some hours in there. I would just go to the ones for radios and stereos because that seems fair, and include that language so as to annoy or disturb the quiet, comfort, or repose of any person of normal sensibilities. But then keep under the exemption, Section 7 exemptions, keep the exemption number 14, normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, except as prohibited by Section 6, sub B.
A reference back to it, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
That sounds good to me.
What's the time frame of the moratorium?
November 30th or December 1st, depending on what you count as the first day that it started. We extended the moratorium on June 3rd, and 180 days from that is November 30th, but it actually expired on June the 4th. So I don't know if the 180 days started on June 3rd when we extended it, or it started on June 4th when the previous one expired.
Sometime in November.
In November. Before the first meeting in December.
There you go.
Clyde is...
Do we need to table this and have it rewritten and brought back next month, or do we want to make a motion to accept that?
I think we need to table to...
I'll make a motion that we table it and have it finalized.
And rewrite it to put that inclusion that Amy just spoke to.
How far have we reached out? I mean, I got to be honest with you. I'm not always in favor of doing what somebody else is doing, but by George, you see me sit up here for 20-some years and say Davidson and Randolph, and they look at us, we look at them, and not just them, though, but how far have we reached out to try to get more scientific or professional with this rather than just to throw darts at it here in our county process?
I mean, I've looked at the quarry operation in Stokesdale, and we have one up north, Martin Marietta.
Yeah,
runs theirs. We have one over at
Huffman Mill
Road. Haven't had any complaints.
But they were there before a lot of that
development. Right, and these people are permitted to put another one in, and going in the future, looking in the future, this will hopefully resolve some of these problems. If you get your land use plan and everything lined up, you won't have this problem.
Okay, so we're going to, I guess, do we need a motion to table?
Steve made that, and I'll second that.
Thank
you.
Second. Clyde's going to keep on writing.
A motion in 4 seconds.
I'll prepare these drafts.
4 seconds.
I'll get this to you red highlighted, just like I did before.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We need to get it right.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right. Sounds good. Thank you. Okay, the county employee health clinic contract. Sherry Hook.
Good evening. So what you have before you tonight is the new contract for the employee health clinic. you will see that it is a little bit different than what we have done in the past. Currently, we have 25 hours a week. This contract would increase our number of hours to 40 hours a week. When we go to that new number of hours, we will have a dedicated physician or physician extender just for our employees. We will have dedicated hours and dedicated space. So we feel that this is a very good thing for our employees. It is also a great cost savings for us. In the contract that you'll see, we have put a minimum number of appointments per day. And if you were to look at those appointments and compare that to what they would, what we as a county would be paying if they were going to a primary care provider, average that out, you'll see that this contract is going to save us about $100,000 if we're able to direct our employees to the clinic. Our clinic is used nonstop. I don't think it's going to be an issue to move us from 25 to 40 hours a week and get it fully utilized. The cost of this contract is $303,822. And this was put in the budget, or we did budget for this as we were doing our new budget.
Go ahead.
I have Lisa Pennington is actually, I think she's in the back room, so she is here from ARMC if you have questions for them as well.
This has been a win-win for the county since the first time we started doing it. So,
physician extender is either a...
This would be like a physician assistant, so they call it a physician extender.
Nurse practitioner.
It is basically the same thing. They're able to write prescriptions. They're able to diagnose. They have a physician that they work under their license who is sort of over them and reviews what they're doing, but is not in the office day to day.
Now, this would be on the facilities at ARMC, right?
It would be. Mm-hmm. In the
it's
Grand Oaks
there. They've been doing it the same place. Well, it's great.
Okay. I'll move that we accept that.
I'll second that.
Great. We have a motion and a second to approve the health clinic contract. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. Now we have the health insurance broker
contract. Thank you, Lisa.
All right, so a couple of months ago, I came to you guys and we talked about putting out a request for qualifications for a new insurance broker. We had seven firms that sent in proposals. We asked five of those firms to come in and do presentations. We had a staff that reviewed those presentations or sat through those presentations from Human Resources, County Manager's Office, Finance Office, and also our legal area. We were looking at these brokers based on their qualifications. We did not look at price until the end. So this is strictly on how we feel like the broker will help us for where we are with our health insurance. And so we have selected USI. And I have John Hilton from USI is here. If you guys have questions for him, the amount or the cost of the contract is $87,465.
What were we paying previously?
We were around $30,000. If you'll remember, we had some issues.
And this was how much again?
$87,465. So it's going to be based on the number of employees on the plan, so it could fluctuate very, very slightly.
We're particularly pleased with USI's ability to, they brought in their legal team, their compliance folks. That was an issue we've had recently, was staying compliant with IRS law. And they were very impressive with the folks they brought in to meet with us. And I think the legal staff were able to meet the legal staff from USI, and we look forward to, if we approve the contract, working with them. I think they'll do a very good job keeping us compliant and helping us find ways to keep the benefits for employees high quality but affordable too. And I will say that just to let the board know, we've really made strides in our insurance program over the past 2 years. You'll recall at the end of 2018, fiscal year 17-18, the fund was over $2 million in the hole.
And we have worked very hard through budgets and through things like the clinic. And we've got the deficit now to about $670,000. So that's about a $1.4 million gain. So we are on track to bring this fund back to the health that it was in. And our team that reviewed the applicants really feel like USI is the group that can help us stay on that track. So.
And where are you located?
We're our Charlotte office. We are here to serve. Fortunate to serve neighboring counties now currently related to Davidson and Gilbert. Also recently been named the city of Robinson.
Okay.
Our team, who works with over a dozen public entities currently, is out of our Charlotte office.
Could you come up, if you don't mind?
Sure.
We won't talk sports.
Yes, sir.
Give us a vendors, if you don't mind. This may be too hypothetical, but or rhetorical, whatever. But a vendor's perspective of what you see in our county, if you don't mind me. Does that make any sense at all?
With our health insurance?
Yeah, with what you're going to be dealing with.
Sure. Any time that we're dealing with health plans, we're overarching wanting to have a plan cost-effective, attractive enough to recruit and retain employees. And so as a result, our philosophy is to have teammates that are locally accessible. Our compliance attorney was mentioned. We also have wellness consultants on our staff who currently have worked with over 30 clients that have on-site clinics like the county does, where we are brainstorming constantly related to ideas and incentives to try to maximize you all's terrific clinic that you have as a tradition here. How can we go deeper with that to encourage preventative care that's free under the ACA, but also help folks be coached related to closing gaps for folks who are chronically ill? And the best coach is right here of your investment that you already have with your on-site clinics. And so that aligns nicely with our philosophy of having on-site wellness directors who have backgrounds of working with clinics. They have backgrounds related to licensed dietitians, exercise physiology, et cetera. So we see that as a need in the county here, really through all of our public entity clients, of saying, okay, how can we be creative around the wellness component? At the same time, bringing compliance services with our in-house attorney, who's accessible by cell phone, as well as actuarial services related to the requirements that we have there for certifying your reserves. And then also we see needs for in-house underwriters to be able to negotiate the insurance coverages with your vendors to be able to do that. And so our lead in working with the county is a gentleman, Larry Reese, whose background, ironically, is an underwriter for Blue Cross and Blue Shield before he became a consultant representing our clients. And so when you combine all of those resources with Larry and our account executive, with our attorney, wellness consultant, we also have technology consultants, etc. That's usually the reason that we're chosen, but we can assure you that we never forget the personal connection and the personal touch related to local service of being right here, accessible every day, because we never forget when we're dealing with health coverage. Usually it can be very visible because you're usually dealing with money and somebody that's sick or they're hurt, and we're to be a good steward of that trust, and we never forget that as a company or as a team.
Well, I can tell you, you know, what we've got here got me to the doctor. I know that, and it's the greatest thing that's ever happened as far as I'm concerned. And they did a full test of me, and you know, I was in pretty good shape, except they said I had to quit eating barbecue so much.
That's terrible.
How's that working?
Well, that didn't work. I still eat too much of it. But yeah, it's impressive, your background.
Thank you.
Does anybody want to make a motion?
I'll support a motion that we go with you.
I'll second that, Tim.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve this contract with the health insurance broker. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you so much. Next item on the agenda says appointment to the Social Services Board.
I'll take this, Chair. So we have two applicants that have applied for the Social Service Board. Ms. Edna Parker is currently serving on the Social Services Board as the appointee by the Board of Commissioners, and she submitted her application to serve for another three-year term. We also have received an application from Mr. Dennis Boone, who is interested in being appointed. So at this time, this is an appointee by the Board of Commissioners. So.
Who knows either one of them?
I was on the board with Ms. Parker. Is she here tonight? Edna Parker?
Yeah, what's she in?
She was, I thought, dynamite. I mean, I thought she was.
Is that good or bad?
Good.
Dynamite can be bad.
Yeah, it can be bad.
I currently serve on the Social Services Board.
What's your
and, she's wonderful. She asks really, really good questions. She knows that agency inside and out. And so she has the insight to ask good questions, and good. She does. I sit on that board. I think she's the best one.
I'll go with Amy.
You can make that motion then.
I will. I will make a motion that we appoint Edna Parker to
the
TSS board.
All right.
So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. Excuse me, next, interlocal agreement with Alamance County Transportation Authority.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you tonight is a memorandum of understanding for the county to renew with ACTA for fiscal year 2020. We have historically done this since fiscal year 16, and what it's doing is it's helping them with their cash flows for their federal grants that they normally do not receive reimbursement for until after October. We did utilize that this past year. We advanced to ACTA $150,000 on November of 2018, and it was repaid in December of 2018. So it's a very fast turnaround. The only change that we see for this agreement this year is to expand it from their 5307 grant to also include their 5310 and their 5311 funding. All other aspects of the grant stay the same.
So basically,
I'll make a motion to approve that.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that agreement. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, now we have two agenda items that may be a little bit longer. Let me check with you all and see if anybody would like a break. It's 8:17, so we've been at it an hour and 15 minutes or so.
Let's take five.
Like a little break? Okay. We'll do that then. We'll take a 10-minute recess. Come to order, please. Next item on our agenda is to review the performance management goals for county departments for the coming fiscal year.
Thank you very much. Commissioners, you have in your packet performance management goals for all Alamance County departments. These have been provided to you for you to be able to review, and we would like for you to approve these goals. The performance management program was set up in order to provide several things, good service to the public and to other county departments, to create efficiencies, and to ensure that Alamance County government remains open and transparent and responsive to its citizens. All county departments have provided goals for the upcoming year, and these goals have been reviewed by county management and a team of folks to look them over and interact with the departments about their proposed goals. The goals that you've got in your list, these should be specific, measurable, meaningful goals that support the overarching initiatives of Alamance County government. Many of the goals from departments are tied to our strategic plan. They're also tied to the fiscal year 19-20 budget. And as we'll go through the fiscal year, departments report regularly. They report monthly to the county manager's office how they're making progress, what success they're having, their workload measures. They provide us this information every month, and then we post that information on the county's website on a monthly basis, so it's available for you or for the public to go and look and see how county departments are doing. So these goals are very important. You know, this year, as well as last year, we reinstituted a merit pay program for county employees. And in order for county employees to qualify to be considered for a merit pay raise, their department where they work must have accomplished at least 75% of these goals. So that's a large incentive for departments to work hard to get these goals completed. So the policy, the performance management policy, requires that I bring these to you every year at the start of the fiscal year for you to have the opportunity to review them and ask any questions that you may have, and then hopefully approve. So at this point, you have the entire list. I'd be happy to try to answer questions about any of them, and we have many of the department heads here to help answer questions too. If you have a question we can't answer, we'll certainly get the information to you.
Let me ask you a hypothetical, a rhetorical question here. All right. I don't know how to phrase it other than, in private business, a lot of times some of the departments lowball their what they want to produce. Steve, you were in banking, and I saw it when I was at the bank. Department head might say, mortgage department might say, well, we're not going to be able to do but X amount of loans this year, all officers individually and then as an aggregate. And it was never an optimistic view. It was always lowballing. And then in private business, in that private business, the CEO would say, you got to do more than that. You got to do more than that. And so my question is in government here locally, do we get involved in, it's hard to believe that human nature isn't here in government, not say in Alamance County, but in government, that it is in private business.
Sure.
And sometimes CEO, i.e. the county manager or somewhere, or city manager, might say, no, you got to do more than that. You got to do better than this. Sure. Do you think that exists?
I do. Most of the time, if a department wants to set a goal, they'll sometimes they will be apprehensive. About, because we're tying folks' raises to these goals, right? So when people set these goals, they really want to know, one, is this important? Is it relevant? Because they're going to spend a lot of time thinking about it. But we'll encourage departments to start off first year, track what you're doing now. So I guess for like the example you use of your mortgage department, we would say we want to take 1 year where we actually monitor what you do at your current effort, right? How successful are you right now? Let's get that as a baseline, and then we do this with almost all the departments. We talk about, okay, your baseline was 80% of whatever it might be. We need you. We know that that is what you can do right now. We think you can push yourself further. How much further do you think you can push yourself? What is this goal? How important is it to the citizen? So usually what we find, and as you look through these goals, we also have these workload measures, where departments are not setting a goal necessarily, they're reporting how many widgets they produce or how many times they do a thing. That's laying groundwork for future goals, because we want them to be successful. And you have the whole spectrum. Some folks that are a little more apprehensive about setting a goal, and then you have other folks that will set a goal very high right off the bat that you have to say, wait, you're not going to do it 100% of the time. You're not going to be able to do whatever it is 100%. Track this for 1 year. So we have found that to be a pretty successful strategy. Track your current productivity. Then let's talk about where do you want to go from here. And some of these goals, sometimes we find that the goals may not really be that important or that relevant to the citizen, right? You set a goal and you say, well, that may not be that relevant. We don't want you to spend a whole lot of time focusing on that. Focus on this other aspect of your departmental operation. And the goals that you have here, they are not indicative of everything the departments do. They for the most part, have said these are the things we feel like are important, support the strategic plan, or the budget that they have presented to us supports it. And that's another important piece of this. When they present a budget to me, I'm looking at, is the budget that I'm going to be able to recommend to the commissioners, does it fund, does it give you the resources you need to do these goals? So I think this program, particularly this goal piece, this is extremely important. It is representative to the public of what the departments do with the money you allocate for them. What do they produce? What results do they have?
I saw a measurement I think I'd like to see in this on the American Medical Services. we talked about this during the budget process, and it was a little difficult coming up with a number of calls they make. That wasn't a problem, but we have agreements with our surrounding counties to support us, and we support them. And I think it would be a good idea for us to be able to see that on some sort of periodic basis. I don't know whether quarterly or semi-annually or annually, but obviously before the next budget process. Because if we look at the number of times we're getting calls deferred or answered by an outside county, that means potential, it would appear to me it would mean a potential for a delay in response time to our citizens. And I think we need to be sensitive to that. We want to make sure we can do it. And how many times is our rescue squad having to back up our EMS service? You know, how many times are they being called on? They have two ambulances in their crash truck. So how many times are they being called on to back up EMS? So we know, you know, if these services need more support. And so, if so, how much and what they might need.
So it sounds like perhaps a good goal for EMS to add would be to report for fiscal year 19-20 the number of times rescue is called to back up EMS, have to respond to a call that EMS is
booked. I'd like to say that too.
Yes.
I think that's important. We need to know.
And also maybe report monthly the number of times out-of-county ambulance services come into Alamance County and the number of times that Alamance County provides that same mutual aid for surrounding counties.
Exactly.
I think that would be pretty easy, Ray, pretty easy stat for us to add to EMS's workload measures.
Yeah, we can definitely track the calls that we run. We'll have to work with the communications department to track the calls that are run inside of Alamance County by outside agencies, because they do that documentation if they run the call. So it's not something that we would document in-house.
Right.
But I feel confident that we can work with CCOM and track that number.
Yeah, I don't want to come up with something that creates a whole other level of stuff you've got to do that detracts from taking care of our citizens, but I think it's important for us to know what needs we have.
Well, I'd like to put Ray on the spot for just a moment. Uh-oh. That'd be all right, because he has a goal that I'd like for him to maybe speak on. If you don't mind, Ray, the goal for EMS is to increase the annual survival rate of greater than 30% for all witness shockable cardiac arrests. I think this is actually a goal that is your object here is to save more lives, basically.
It is.
And I got to tell you, I appreciate the department setting that as a goal to work toward to track, particularly these cardiac arrests. And I think y'all have done a lot of work with your folks on this. So I don't know if you want to speak to that, but that's pretty yeah. ambitious.
What are you doing there? That's
so
ambitious.
You know, and this. So when you look at cardiac arrest, you look at a lot of different ways, but so we're looking at a very specific subset of cardiac arrest victims, these folks that somebody watches them go into cardiac arrest, and then they have a shockable rhythm, you know, one that an AED would recognize, or we could recognize with our manual defibrillators. And so the idea is that we would get hands on the chest very, very quickly to help keep oxygen flowing to the brain until we could get there and work. So we're, you know, it's kind of an ambitious goal, but we're doing a lot of internal changes trying to get to that 30% survival. Mm-hmm. And you know, death is a universal thing, so it's hard to conquer, but you know, there are folks out there that can be saved, so we're working to try to save all that we can.
Good.
That's a good goal.
It is a good goal. I call it out just because I appreciate it's the fact that it's ambitious, and it's without doubt in the best interest of the citizens of the county to have the EMS department set that as a goal and then work very hard to make that happen.
And this is one that our medical director, Dr. Qualley, has really pushed and really been behind us and really working hard to help us achieve. So good plug for him too, because he's really worked very hard on that.
Yes. Well, it was a piece of equipment that gentleman really complained about or suggested we get, and we were going to buy a few. Was that the
Lucas devices, compression devices.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Where are we with that?
So right now we have one that responds to every cardiac arrest. So we have one on our supervisor vehicle in Graham.
Okay.
And then we have one on each of our medic units that are out in the county. And so You know, the stats don't show that those necessarily save more lives than manual CPR, but what they are, they're great labor savers. So we're able to, we respond to medic unit or the supervisor to every cardiac arrest in the county so we can get there, and it really does help relieve the personnel demands, sometimes keeps you from having to send two ambulances to a cardiac arrest, or can free up the fire departments once the Lucas device gets there. So it's been a great addition to the
county. What does the device do?
So it straps on and it runs on a battery and it just does compressions at 102 compressions per minute.
I think I've heard Ray say that for actually, if CPR needs to be done during transport in the ambulance, it's
much more.
Yeah, you can get that consistency out rather than a paramedic
standing over the patient while you're driving and running, doing the compressions.
You ever been in an ambulance going over speed bumps?
Yeah. I have to say, I took the emergency driving course, and Captain Mahoney from Burlington Fire drove with me in the back. And
it is a different experience.
It is. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Ray. I'd also just quickly like to call attention to the Sheriff's Office goals. The Sheriff's Department have done a very good job this year. I think Travis Hackney has worked for the Sheriff's Department, putting together some very good goals that have to do with, at one point, developing strategies to recruit and retain folks at the Sheriff's Department, particularly in our detention area. We struggle. The Sheriff's Department struggles retaining folks and keeping folks. We're working with them to try to do that. Also, would call your attention to some of the goals that the Sheriff's Department have set. Where they develop and implement saturation patrol and community-based policing based on citizen complaints. They will be targeting areas of the county to really pour resources in and try to. I think that's an admirable goal. Appreciate the Sheriff's Department doing that. I think citizens, those are the kind of goals that citizens will really see the benefit of as they are implemented. Life-saving, focusing on citizen complaints, saturating an area of the county for high-level policing. So very, very good goals.
I really like this approach because it gives the citizens a way to know that county departments are being held accountable.
Right.
I noticed there were the inspections department. They have a goal that 98% of inspections will be performed within 24 hours of a request.
Builders appreciate that too.
Yeah,
they do.
And then they maintain an average turnaround on construction plan reviews at 2 days or less, with either approval given or comments sent. I think that's awesome.
That's it is. We get a lot of good comments from the developers of Alamance County and the builders, Robert Key, Roger Allison, Lisa Thomas. Those folks at inspections work very hard to keep that service up to that high level. And it's great for builders. That means their equipment isn't sitting around paying for that equipment, waiting on the right county to get out there and do their thing. It's getting turned around very quickly. And professionally, I have to say, they do a very good job. So.
I also noticed that for our maintenance department, that maintenance will complete 81% of work orders initiated in a given month by the end of the next scheduled work day. I think that's really good. 81% done in
reckon we could get that passed to the school.
Well, I have to say, county maintenance over the past 4 or 5 years have implemented this Facility Dude software, and it has helped them tremendously. I'm sure Buddy and all the guys and gals down there would say they use it to save time. They're able to get a work order. If they're in this building working and a work order comes in from this building, they get it right on their phone. They know, I just go right on upstairs and do the next one. I don't have to go back to base and figure it out. So they, and you know, here's a goal in a department that doesn't provide a lot of direct service to the citizen. Their service is support to other county departments. But if they're turning work orders around 81% of the time within 1 day, that means county government's continuing to run. You know, things are breaking, they're getting fixed. Nobody's sitting around saying, gosh, I can't do the thing for the citizen because I can't get it fixed. They're doing a very good job.
Well, do we know if ABSS maintenance is using a similar program? Or?
They do use, my understanding is they use the School Dude version. So we have Facility Dude for county government. They do have School Dude, which is like a brand of the same software. But it is very powerful and has made a huge difference in county maintenance for sure.
I think it's really good that the maintenance department, too, it's number 9 says that the staff will do a walkthrough of one county building each month to identify and address cleaning and maintenance repair issues, just to put eyes on the buildings. Yes. I think that's really good.
That's important. It is.
That's important.
That's Joel Brooks in maintenance has made that a goal to try to stay ahead of it. Don't wait for, you know, either the public to bring it to maintenance's attention or the county staff. Take a building, go through and tour it, and get on whatever's going on in there that they can fix. So.
All right. This is for information. No vote required.
Yeah, very good.
Yep, that's good stuff. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Did anybody else have any more questions? I don't want to cut anybody off. All right, community health assessment for 2018. Stacy Saunders in the health department.
Partly. But good evening.
Good evening.
So some of you who have been on the board for a while are aware that local health departments in North Carolina are required to complete a community health assessment at least every 4 years. And Alamance County completes their community health assessment every 3 years to align with our hospital partners. And our last CHA, or what we call a CHA, community health assessment, was completed in 2015. And tonight, members of the health department and Healthy Alamance will be presenting an overview of the 2018 community health assessment for you. And so it's a requirement by the Division of Public Health, and it must be submitted to them for review. And our community health assessment has been submitted and has received approval from Division of Public Health. And I'm pleased to say that the feedback that we got from our report from DPH stated that our team had excelled in producing an exceptional community health assessment. And so this process and this report could not be possible without a lot of other partners. So it's not just the health department that does this. When it's called a community health assessment, it's a lot of the community that does this. And you'll hear a lot about the process when Ann and Arlinda talk. But I would like just to take a moment to quickly acknowledge some of the partners in the room who came to support us tonight as we present this to you all. And so, like I said, the health department is a part of this. Healthy Alamance is a part of this. Alamance Regional Medical Center, Cone Health is a part of this, the United Way, Impact Alamance, and Elon University. And so tonight, Ann Maletsky, who is the executive director from Healthy Alamance, and Arlinda Ellison, who is the health education supervisor at the health department, will be presenting the CHA for you.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
So I am Arlinda, and I'm going to jump right into our assessment. So Stacy has already gone over our partners, and so you can see them listed there. And also to note our three priorities, which are economy, access to care, and education. These three priorities were the same priorities we had in 2015. And the community has chosen to keep these as a priority because there's more work to be done to achieve success in these areas. As you know, change does not happen overnight. It can take years. It can take decades. We don't want it to take decades, but it can take decades. And so our leadership at the Division of Public Health granted us the latitude and flexibility to continue working on these priorities towards an optimal state of health in our education system, our economy, and healthcare. So together as a community, we have identified needs, what we're doing well, and what we might need to do a little bit better. And so those are the things we're gonna discuss tonight. And so we're gonna start with some demographics. So in Alamance County, the white population makes up about 2/3 of the population, while other races comprise just under 1/3 of the population. And as you can see, the Hispanic ethnicity makes up 13.9% of the population, which notes that an increased growth within the past 3 years. So next, we want to look at population. As you can see in Alamance County, the majority of our population is between, say, 25 and 65. And as with many counties that have a college or a college town, that population can change around 8 to 9 months of the year. You know, when the students come into Elon, we have an influx of 18 to 23-year-olds, and when they leave, there's basically 64 and over. So so we note this so that our interventions, we can address certain communities, and our approach has to be tailored depending on what the population is during that time frame. So next, what this map is, this is mortality data from the North Carolina State Center of Health Statistics. And what it shows, that green line, that is a 3-mile radius showing the life expectancy. What you're seeing is from East Burlington to West Burlington, there is an 11.2-year difference in life expectancy, meaning those in East Burlington will die on average 11 years earlier than those in West Burlington. And so again, this comes from the State Center of Health Statistics, their mortality data. And so this is an alarming statistic. And so all of the work that we do here in the community, we want to address this and understand why is this happening and what can we do to change this trend. Next, you'll see some demographic, some economic demographics. On one side of the chart, you'll see median household income, that's on the left, and on the right, you'll see children living below the poverty level. And what you can notice, and what we found is that even with the changes in median income, whether it's going up or down, we're noticing that child poverty is continuing to go up. And so that is also a concerning statistic. And I mentioned when I presented some months ago the State of the County Health Report that our children in poverty is equivalent to about the size of the town of Elon, just to kind of put it in a numerical perspective for you. So that's about how many children we have in poverty in this county. And when we're looking at costs, we've noted that between 2012 and 2016, child care has increased by 234%, rising more than any basic need. We know child care is very expensive, from $482 to $1,429 per month. And this is in Alamance County. Health care has increased by 188%. From $188 a month to $542 a month. Housing has increased by 88%, from $488 to $920 per month for a 2-bedroom unit. Food has increased from $477 to $734, which is a 54% increase. So as you can see, there are some things that we need to look at, and this is possibly some reason behind our child poverty levels. And as you can see, these are the children below the poverty level, not at the poverty level. This slide is just basically showing you what our employment is by industry. You can see the majority of the industry here is nonprofit, education, and government. Also manufacturing, trade, and utilities, followed by retail and medical and healthcare. Those are the main employers here in our county. The leading causes of death, these are the 10 leading causes of death in the county. They have not changed in a number of years. What is to note is cancer and heart disease are 1 and 2, and basically they just shift from one to the other. Sometimes heart disease is 1 and then cancer is 1. And on the surface, you know, older populations tend to experience more chronic illness. And so this could be the reason for cancer and heart disease being 1 and 2. But as we look a little deeper, we also understand that obesity, lack of built environments such as sidewalks and parks for exercise, and influx of fast food could possibly be some other reasons that contribute to these high rates of cancer and heart disease. The next slide is showing our infant mortality rate. So infant mortality is an area of concern and interest for us here in the county. And what I briefly am showing you is between a 15-year trend. Overall, our infant mortality has decreased by about 50%. For the 15-year, you can see it went from 8.7 to 5.2. So we are actually below the state average for infant mortality. However, we have not seen this type of change among African-American children, babies. This should not, and we don't want to treat this as just another statistic. We as a community, we want to think about how to change the statistic because this is a very alarming statistic. Now, it is important to note that we don't have many infant deaths here in the county. For instance, in 2017, we had 10 deaths. But out of those 10 infant deaths before the age of one, six of them were African American. So we want to get an understanding of what is happening here and why is the statistic remaining still high.
What is the, if you don't mind me asking, what is the, it's where the baby just passes away in the crib. What's that called?
SIDS.
Yeah.
Sudden infant
death. Right, yeah. Is that part of these stats here?
That would be inclusive if it is before the age of
what,
one.
What has been the trend with that lately, over the decade? Do you, can you speak to that?
See it specifically?
Yeah.
I don't know what the trend has been because it will all be lumped in the deaths before one, but many of those cases are due to SIDS.
Yeah.
I mean, some is preterm birth.
Right. So just going on memory, casual memory, you know, it's been sort of a panic situation with parents, you know, that could happen so easily. And have they ever figured out what's going on with that? I mean, what studies, or I know it's a rhetorical question, but what has research shown is causing that to be such a stat? Yeah.
I luckily have Dr. Minter, who is a Board of Health Mentor member with us tonight. But many of the SIDS cases are somewhat idiopathic. We're not really sure what happens, and they're still studying that. And over the years, particularly with new practices around back to sleep, so putting babies on their backs to sleep, I don't know about you all, but if you told my granny that she'd be like, that's not how we do that, right? But a lot of that has changed over time, and now we put babies on their backs to sleep to keep that airway totally open and unobstructed. But what we do see as a growing, somewhat of a growing trend with suffocation, which is slightly different than SIDS, because of co-sleeping. And so, you know, there's some protective pieces to co-sleeping that happen, and we don't want to negate that, but there's also some really dangerous things about suffocation through co-sleeping, and that sometimes that bonding, what perceives as a sort of bonding, can actually be detrimental to the baby. I hope that answers a little bit of...
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, just switched up a little bit.
Okay, so now that you've seen our statistics, demographic data, we want to give a little feedback on some successful strategies we've had since our last assessment in 2015. So for one, kindergarten readiness. We have developed a countywide kindergarten readiness definition, and this has happened with Alamance Partnership for Children, also Alamance Achieves. And so through Alamance Achieves, we have developed a kindergarten readiness definition, which is actually a big thing. Might not sound like a big thing, but that's a big thing because now we have a baseline of where children can be tested and truly understanding what kindergarten ready means. So this is actually a significant thing. And then the bonds, as you know, you all are voting to approve the $150 million school bond for ABSS in November 2018. This bond will repair several infrastructure issues at high schools in the county and build a new high school, which you know, in the southeastern part of the county that is desperately needed due to population growth. And a significant bond in Alamance County has not been passed like this since the 1950s. Also, the $30 million bond for Alamance Community College was passed. And so we consider these as a part of our successful strategies since 2015. Additionally, the farmers market, this provides it, and it adds an entrepreneurial support and opportunities for local farmers, as well as restaurants, bakeries, independent salespersons. If you haven't been to the farmers market, you go out there and you see there are people selling soaps and goods and bakery items in addition to vegetables. So not only is this a great asset for agriculture, but also for the economy. And then smoke-free. The city of Graham, as well as the city of Burlington and Green Level, has gone smoke-free. So we consider this as a successful strategy for our community.
Good evening, everybody. How are you?
Good evening. Fine.
Thank you for the opportunity to present this evening. I realize it's a long evening, so I'll try to go through this very quickly. The key thing that you need to take away from this part of the presentation is that the 2018 community assessment is based on conversations with the community. I heard a lot about that tonight throughout this commissioner meeting. We asked folks what they want, we asked them what they need, and we asked them what they're worried about. And so I'm going to break down for you very quickly the methodology that we used. It's very similar to what we've done in the past, with the exception of adding in those key focus groups there in the middle. We always partner with Elon University Polling Center to conduct a poll. We also usually conduct at least one focus group, conducted in Spanish, because the poll is only conducted in English, or offered in English, rather. Like Arlinda mentioned, we retained our 2015 priorities this time around. We conducted a community forum in February where we continued those conversations. We have also offered a photo voice project and are currently working on developing a health equity group. And I'll talk more about those in just a minute. So this is just a glimpse of the poll to give you a snapshot of what that looks like. What I can say about that is that we're really fortunate to have Elon University as a partner in conducting these assessments. And while it's a really important piece of demonstrating community involvement, it isn't sufficient for a conversation with the community about health equity. So this year we were able to reduce our sample size. We were able to poll residents with cell phones in addition to landline. And we were also able to shorten the number of questions, which allowed for it to be an easier interview for residents. This came down from the state. This was a state requirement. The state said that they recognized that most counties across North Carolina really haven't adequately captured the narrative of residents whose health is most impacted by the decisions that are made. And so this model, we were told, needed to be incorporated into the assessment. Didn't tell us how to do it, just told us that we needed to do it and that the assessment needed to really be able to demonstrate that there were ongoing conversations in the community around health equity. So this was incorporated into our focus group discussions, allowing us to explore the challenges that residents have in regard to putting a roof over their head or food on their table, and how that impacts their health, that of their families, and their neighbors. Some of the key findings that came out of the focus groups are listed up there. An important takeaway here is that we talked with residents about what their concerns are, particularly as they pertain to, to health. So they shared with us issues that they have with establishing consistent care, and therefore have real difficulty in trusting the health care that they receive, if they choose to receive any at all. We talked about how hard it can be to get and retain a job in Alamance County. They often feel like they have to go outside the county in order to get employment that's stable long-term for themselves. And they worry about how they're gonna get around in the community and how they're gonna access the things that they need.
So we were able to partner with those that participated in the focus groups to plan and participate in a community forum that was conducted on February 20th. I'll talk more about that in a minute, but I'm going to show you some quotes that line up with the themes that you just saw come out of those focus groups. So in this one, people were expressing frustration that while everyone has the same needs, everyone doesn't always receive the same services. In this one, participants said that they recognized how easy it is to be blame the individual for their own health issues, but when the same issues continue to affect a group of people, that it's time for us to look at our organizations and our processes, much in the way we were just talking about with EMS, thinking about their processes and setting that high measure. In this one, we heard from the Okanichi how they alluded to top-down solutions not working for marginalized people. They described scenarios from childhood where a census interviewer would check the race box without allowing them to self-identify, meaning that essentially they were defined within their entire household based off of how that interviewer interpreted or perceived them. We've talked a little bit about this pervasive sort of lack of trust in the healthcare system, and I can tell you that the health agencies that you heard earlier that are partners in all of this are looking very closely at the feedback that we're receiving from the community and trying to think about how we can begin to partner with the community to address those issues. And finally, this quote was in alignment with job stability. And obviously, I've simplified all of this to fit into a really short presentation, and you all know that these are really complex issues that can't be resolved currently with the way we're doing things. So, but we do believe that when you start to ask people what they want and what they need, you're on the road to the right answer. Essentially, we've relied on quantitative data that was insufficient in providing a thorough picture of community health, and so now we're moving forward to see how we can partner with the community to craft some solutions. Here's the forum that I was telling you about earlier, some of the themes that came out of that. That was conducted February 20th, and there were about 135 residents who came out for that. We held that at the Mako Bigelow Center. Some of the discussions centered around some of the things we've talked about tonight, development opportunities in some of the more overlooked areas of the county, particularly the urban-rural divide and the rural parts of Alamance County, north and south. Residents wanting to partner with us to come up with solutions to issues of health, continuing to focus on improving education in Alamance, but recognizing that there need to be opportunities to create career paths for families who can't afford to send their children to college, the desire to see more mixed income and intergenerational housing to aid in creating a sense of community. Isolation was a topic or a theme that we heard across all the focus groups that we conducted. And finally, we wanted to continue that conversation with them after the forum. So we had a photo voice project, which is for a much smaller group, about 10 to 12 people. We conducted this in the spring. It's a method used to document and reflect reality. So participants are asked to express their points of view or represent their communities by photographing scenes that are in alignment with the themes of the research that we were conducting. You see the questions that we discussed over a 5-week span. And the one thing that I would say about Photo Voice is it provides you an opportunity for a group of strangers to come together and have really meaningful conversations about really sensitive subjects in a very short period of time. So I'm going to stop here and send this back over to Arlinda so she can wrap up the presentation. I encourage you to reach out to me with any questions you have.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to wrap this up. Finally, in things that we're doing well, you know, we do a lot of collaboration here in the county. There is no way possible that the health department can do everything, so work with our partners in the community is imperative. The one thing that is happening is NC Care 360. This is a new statewide tool to make it easier for providers, insurers, and community-based organizations to connect people with the community resources that they need to be healthy. The platform will connect community-based organizations to each other across the state so they can collaborate while allowing for the tracking of system-wide outcomes and supporting system improvement. Alamance County is one of three counties selected for the pilot. So right now, we're one of the first counties to use NC Care 360, along with Guilford and Rockingham. And so we have been really big users so far of this system. And the main things that they cover is housing, transportation, clothing, food, intimate partner violence recovery. We know these are social drivers of health and can affect physical health. And so NC Care 360 helps to make these resources more accessible and in a timely fashion. It will also help us to address many of the needs that we've already talked about tonight through the assessment. And so a few other things that we're doing well that I wanted to just add on at the end. AC HOPE stands for Alamance County HOPE. That is our opioid prevention task force that we have here, and this is also multi-sector. This is the health department working along with EMS, law enforcement, harm reduction, treatment facilities, all with the focus of reducing opioid overdose, opioid deaths here in the county. And so we are working really well with that right now. Also, Centering Pregnancy. This is a group pregnancy program that we have at the health department. And the reason I mention this is because this helps to target us on that reduction of infant mortality. Centering pregnancy is the one thing that's been shown to close the gap between white and African-American babies when it comes to infant deaths. And so this is something we have in our health department. We are trying to make it a standard of care and hopefully to expand it into other clinics. So just wanted to let you know about that. And we're doing many, many other things, but I won't touch on that tonight because we'll be here for a while. But the assessment can be found on our website, the health department website, in addition to Piedmont Health Counts. And so I encourage you to go on and look at the entire document. It's a pretty, it's a big document. So I encourage you to go back and look at it. And if you have any questions, please feel free to contact myself or Ann. Are there any other questions?
Thank you.
Good job.
Any questions? All right, thank you so much. Next, we have our budget amendments. We have one for the Children's Dental Clinic.
All right. So as I said earlier during Mr. Sutton's question, attending with me tonight is Board of Health member Dr. Karen Mentor. Our chair and dentist representative on the board very much wanted to attend with me tonight but couldn't. So Dr. Mentor is attending on her behalf as our physician member as I present this new budget amendment for you. And the Alamance County Children's Dental Clinic has been awarded a Duke Endowment Foundation grant in the amount of $430,000. Some of you might remember that it was the Duke Endowment that helped us get the dental clinic started many years ago, maybe almost 20 now.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
I think so. Also, you might remember just last year that the dental clinic received a planning grant from the Duke Endowment in a small amount of money to help them do technical assistance and consultation and planning for this particular project, and then has been awarded the implementation grant, which is what's before you today. And initially, the dental clinic will receive an allocation of $250,000, and the remaining $180,000 will be dispersed in increments through June 30th of 2021. These funds will be used to establish a school-based dental preventative and treatment program in Alamance County Elementary Schools. And Dr. Mentor will tell you a little bit about what we are doing with the funds if approved tonight.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome.
So the dental clinic's mission is to create a portable school-based dental clinic to provide quality dental care, increasing learning time by decreasing the hours missed for appointments, and also reducing barriers like transportation so that children can receive excellent oral health care. The foundation funds will be used to hire one dentist, two assistants, and a care coordinator. We will be providing diagnostic, preventative, and restorative dental services to all eligible children. These include sealants and fillings and that stuff on site. The clinic will start this school year, and eight area schools will receive these services.
And so, before you tonight,
is the budget amendment to accept these funds. These are foundation funds. There are no local tax dollars for a match in this. These are all foundation funds for the dental clinic, which also is fully self-sustaining and does not take any local tax dollars.
What schools?
Great question. So I will look that for you. The eight schools are South Graham, North Graham, Hall River, Andrews, B.E. Jordan, Pleasant Grove, Grove Park, and Sylvan. And so during that planning phase of that first pot of money that came last year, that smaller pot, they worked on getting the MOUs and the partnership agreements together with the school system. Oh, okay. And so our school system has been a great partner in this and realizes that, you know, tackling access to care is sometimes meeting people where they are, and that might actually be at the school.
Right. Very good.
I'd like a motion to approve this.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve this budget amendment for the Children's Dental Clinic. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay.
Well, and on behalf of the Board of Health, I just want to thank all of you very much for approving this budget amendment for the Duke Endowment to this school-based dental clinic. As a pediatrician, I can tell you the importance of dental health, oral health in general, is huge. I mean, this affects your entire body. So I that's why I'm here, partly as a Board of Health member. Thank you for sitting on the board with me. And also just because you got to start somewhere, and this is a big start.
Is there any way to allow referrals from the schools that aren't included to these other sites?
So these are just the first eight.
Just starting.
So we're just starting out with these, and then the hope is that it would grow bigger than that. So we're starting with eight. And hopefully I'll be able to come back to you with an update that says we're expanding.
Great.
Very good.
Thank you so much. All right, we have a budget adjustment from the district attorney's office.
Yes, good evening, commissioners. Before you this evening is a budget amendment in the amount of $24,000 for the PSN Safe Alamance Strategy Coordinator position. This will be a contracted position funded by the Alamance County Sheriff's Department, as well as the Burlington Police Department, Graham Police Department, and Mebane Police Departments. It's a collaborative agreement for them to have, and the PSN actually stands for Public Safety. Let me make sure I get the right one. Project Safe Neighborhoods, I'm sorry about that, which is a leading violence reduction strategy of the U.S. Department of Justice. What this will do is it will allow us to budget for the revenue that we expect from the outside police departments, and the sheriff's contribution is already included in his 1920 adopted budget.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that budget adjustment. Is it an adjustment or an amendment?
It would be an amendment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, because it says adjustment on the agenda. So we have a motion and a second to approve that. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, and then we have one last budget amendment for a county capital project.
Yes, so what this will do is it will allow us to rearrange our capital plan and our budget that we currently have for our capital projects. We will be able to reallocate $116,666 to replace a jail chiller. And there is no impact to the general fund.
This jail chiller is listed as one of our capital plan projects for this year in the approved capital plan.
How long it's going to take now?
Buddy would speak a little better to this, but it will be several weeks. And I think the hope is the chiller will last through the summer, because if we take it down now, we'll have to bring in temporary cooling. So the chiller has been given a problem to the detention center for a couple of years. Like I say, we just hope it'll make it through the hot weather. And if it does, we'll do it in the fall when it's cooler. But Buddy, is there anything you can add to that?
From time it's ordered, I get the purchase order for it. It takes 6 to 8 weeks to get it in, and approximately 12 weeks for it to be installed.
So we might be in the cooler weather, no matter what.
But it is back up and running now?
Yes.
Okay, good.
But it is ready to.
On its last leg.
It is. This is one of those projects you're better off planning for if you can, rather than reacting to when it goes out.
Was over there the other day. It was 95 degrees outside, and they were coming outside to cool off. Not the prisoners, but
they wanted to.
They wanted to. I know. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve this amendment.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment. All in favor? Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right. Next, we have on the agenda, we have three more public speakers. The first is, and I'm sorry for the name butchering, Chuli Schott. S-C-H-A-C-H-T is the last name. Is that person here? Is there anybody still in the overflow room? You know? Let's double check. He would have waited this long. We don't. Nope, nobody. Okay. Will?
Nobody in overflow.
Maybe he changed his mind. All right, Donna Pope.
Hello.
Hey. Hello.
It's a lighter crowd when you wait till the end.
That's right.
Thank you for still being here, though. So, yes, I'm Donna Poe, and thank you once again for the opportunity to speak to you this evening. As you are well aware, a letter was sent on July 1st to the county attorney, copied to each of you and the planning department director, which cited omissions and violations in the original HIDO permit approval process, which clearly renders the permit to Snow Camp Property Investments invalid, with a request made to discuss the issue further. The letter intention was an invite for communication and a plea for a thorough investigation. We believe these findings would be of interest to you, the commissioners, in that you have repeatedly asked the county attorney if all procedures were followed in the issuing of that permit. If you read the listed points in the letter, that include, among other things, deficient stream identification and buffers, an absence of a spacing waiver from an adjacent property owner, I would think you would be concerned and want to take a serious look at this matter. Instead, the county attorney unfortunately dismissed the letter with his reply just one day later, citing his position that the permit holder has common law vested rights. We've heard that several times here, to what we believe to be an invalid permit. The state of North Carolina recognizes vested rights only under valid permits, as stated in the committee report from the North Carolina School of Government, in which I have a copy for each of you here, along with and also described in Senate Bill 355 as referenced often by Mr. Albright and most recently at the June 17th meeting. In other words, again, let me be clear, there are no vested rights conveyed under an invalid permit. If Mr. Albright needs a case to support that position, then he can reference Mecklenburg versus Westbury, where a permit was determined to be invalid, eliminating vesting despite 10 years of activity under that permit. Mr. Albright further stated in his reply that he was passing the letter on to Mr. Tom Terrell, the attorney for the permit holder, and referred us to him. Unless Mr. Terrell also represents the county, then we have no reason to contact Mr. Terrell. You've told us repeatedly that you believe that this HIDO permitting activity was butchered and that you were tired of just talking about it without the power to do anything. We are tired of talking too, along with the ongoing, what we believe to be pushback from the county attorney and his misinformation. This is your chance to do something against this quarry, to stop this quarry from happening with fact-based citations as listed in that letter. We are requesting that you appoint an independent committee, perhaps from planning board members, to examine the procedures that took place in reviewing this permit application, with special focus on the points listed in our letter. Based on this review, you would be in a better position then to determine if the permit was issued in error and as such is invalid and should be revoked. Thank you for your consideration and your continued leadership.
Thank you.
And so I have for each of you here, as I referenced in my comment, it's the full committee report from the UNC School of Government, and I've turned it to the pages here of my references where I highlighted what I was talking about. The full Senate Bill 355, again, I turned to the page referencing about the permit not being valid and therefore there's no vesting. And then another copy of the letter that was sent to you all. You already received a copy, but I thought just for uniformity here, I would include that. And also, in case by chance you didn't get a copy of the reply back from Mr. Albright, because he didn't have you copied on that letter, I have a copy of that for you too.
Thank
you again so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is all of this going to Raleigh as well?
Yes.
Thank you. Next, let's hear from David Schuker.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, David.
Kind of late night, but still, I won't keep you long. So I lived here in Alamance County for most of my life. I bought a house back when I was 24 out in the southern Alamance area. I live and work here in Alamance. And I bought the house. I lived there for 13 years. And come in 2018, we had an unfortunate house fire. So I wonder what happened and what changed after that. We decided to stay here in Alamance County and live our lives on. We built a new house. But since then, I've been constantly reminded from a neighbor of what I'm not doing right. I keep up with my yard. I try to keep everything nice and maintained around the house. I work and I go to school. I have a wife and two kids. And we, you know, do what a family does. I was just wondering what changed and why it's all of a sudden here in the 15th year, and why I'm getting all these complaints.
Who are you getting them from?
My neighbor. Should I state the name? No. Okay. Just when the fire happened, everybody around the community, the churches, the locals, really stepped up. Didn't know that. Had no idea that there was so much support for stuff like that.
What part of the county are you in?
Southern Alamance.
You're in the southern. Yes, sir. You're not in a municipality or anything. So.
No, sir. Yes, and I don't dare to step over to his property, but I don't have enough strong support that he steps to mine. But he has a lot of pictures that he sends outside. So, but has anything changed as far as rights or anything
to
the counties
changed.
Or anything? Okay.
What's the nature of the complaints you're receiving?
Yard not being mowed. Hedges not being trimmed, water running red where I've been building and doing construction on my property, red water touching his grass. I'm up on a mountain, so of course all my water runs to his.
There's not much you can do about a neighbor like that.
Not much you can do about it either. So.
Gravity.
I think I'm a little familiar with the situation with Mr. Shoup. And is Tanya still here? I don't see her. Tanya, I don't know if there's anything you can say or want to say about Mr. Shoup's conflict. That's all right. Mr. Shoup's conflict with his neighbor.
You know, from a code enforcement perspective, we get complaints by email, by phone, just however, and we just respond to them. We've been in contact. I know this situation. We've been in contact with both parties. Rules have not changed for the county in some time, though. These ordinances okay. have been on for a while, but we just have to respond to each complaint, and that's all we do.
And we don't have a grass mowing ordinance.
We cannot have a height of a grass, no.
No, next time he comes, the doctor, you tell him to get his ass off your property. That's what I did with him. That's exactly what I did. That solves a lot of problems.
You don't have to put up with that. That's just.
That's how I would handle it.
A few times.
The second time, he would be sorry he came over.
Thank you for everybody that's
all about it. On a personal note, I haven't seen you in how long? How many years has it been?
Probably about 27.
It's amazing. I had Scoot come up here. Remember Scoot?
Yeah,
the black boy took Clemson, and I saw you. I didn't recognize you. I do now. But you told me that you said you went with us to some Durham Bull baseball games.
The old stadium, yes, sir.
How old were you then?
14
years old.
Did he mess you up?
Well, I will tell you, his family, he and his, they're some of the finest people Timmy ever knew. And he moved out of the neighborhood before we could get him down to Clemson, but I would have took him to Clemson too. But But anyway, you're a fine young man, and
hope you can get that resolved.
Thank you. Thank you.
Maybe don't take her advice.
Do we have, before we go on, we've responded to Mr. Sheep. Do we have anybody who has a response to Donna Poe?
Where is the state in all this? I mean, what are they trying to figure out? What day of the week it is? I mean, what's going on with this?
I have no idea what they're doing in the Mining Commission. They're reviewing reports, asking for additional information. That's what they do.
But is the process this long with everything they're doing?
Well, it depends on what additional information they ask for. I don't know the status of that.
On June 21st, the Mining Commission asked for 10 pages of additional information from the petitioner, and that information has not shown up yet.
They might have to do some additional testing. I'm not sure what they're up to. It's in their ballpark, though.
It's in our county.
Well, thank you for bringing this information. I look forward to taking a look at it and reviewing it. Okay, do we have a county manager report this evening?
No, we do not. Thank you.
Do we have any commissioner comments on anything else?
I do. I got something I want to bring up. The letter from Miranda Eisen about the problems with the dog pound or
the feral cats.
Is there a problem with the county and between the county and the city? If the city's not doing what they agreed to, I think there's a problem.
I know the Sheriff's Department was made aware of Ms. Eisen's concerns, and the Sheriff's indicated that his staff met with the Burlington Animal Services staff today, talked about this issue. I think they've also reached out to Ms. Eisen, and they're working with the neighbor that's been receiving the feral cats, trying to find a solution, perhaps to limit the number of cats that are taken to the neighbor's property, and also to work with the neighbor to try to prevent the cats that he does have from going on Ms. Eisen's properties. But I do think there are some issues that we need to work through with the city of Burlington. There's some real concerns.
I thought we had that problem before. I thought we had that solved.
Well, I think there's been, my understanding from the Sheriff's Department has been there's been a lot of good headway made between the staffs.
There has been. I'll just be honest with you, I think there's one problem up there.
They need to solve that problem. They need to get rid of that group.
It's going to
and get somebody that
if it continues,
follows rules.
I'm sure it's going to come to a head. However, yeah. We have made a lot of progress working with the director over there, and I think she is trying to straighten that particular problem out, but certainly if it continues, we intend to meet it head on.
We've had some discussions with the city leadership about the possibility of the municipalities and the county that's being served by their department having the ability to make these concerns known in a more organized and official way. So I think the city staff may not totally understand what these concerns are. So having discussions with them, making it very clear that the other municipalities in the county want to make sure that there's a good balance between saving animals, rescuing animals, and being a good neighbor too.
Yeah. So.
Does this person live in the Burlington city limits? I looked at the address, and I believe it's behind Glen Raven corporate headquarters there, and they're kind of between Flora and whatever his name that road that Glen Raven's on.
According to the GIS, they're in the rural unincorporated county. They are in the ETJ of Burlington, but they're not in the city limits. So I think in that case, the Sheriff's Department would be responding to the animal control calls.
Interesting.
So it's been so noted as a concern. I think the sheriff's department has started the conversation with how to address this particular issue at this person's house.
Yeah.
But it is indicative that we are going to have a conversation with the city.
We need a procedural conversation of how to handle.
Well, one of the things that I was wondering, doesn't Burlington City have a rule about how many animals a person can have in their home?
Sure, mm-hmm. Three animals.
Three.
Just dogs. Three.
Just dogs.
Just dogs. No cats. Cats. No rules on cats.
No limit on cats.
That's interesting.
So I'm certain that we'll be meeting with city leadership about the policies and procedures at the animal services, and hopefully be able to solicit some input from the other municipalities that are served too.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
We definitely need to solve that problem.
Yes.
Thank you for raising that concern. Mm-hmm. All right, anybody else?
Well, I had something I wanted to talk about. I brought to my attention by one of our constituents who happens to be in the room today. After the work session of the ABSS, a comment was made by one of their board members about how much they were going to be having to spend for architects. Combined, it looked like about $6 million. A comment that was made, why don't we buy an architectural firm or hire our own architects? $6 million. I mean, we've got jobs we're looking at for Alamance County. I mean, $6 million just for architects. I've been trying to promote the idea of us at least looking and considering the option of some sort of public-private partnership. And I've been doing some exploring. Dale Falwell promised to send me some material on his white paper on public-private partnerships, but I have people who would be willing to come and make a presentation to us about what the options are if the board is interested in at least hearing about them. One of the options would be there are three basic options. One is design build. Second one is builder risk. And the last one's called triple P, and it involves a variety of different inclusions of those options. But not necessarily just for ABSS. I'd extend that invitation to the ABSS board as well if they want to join us. But I know that the presentation was made to them by their staff, but still, we've got programs we're looking at, facilities that need to be improved and added to, that we ought to at least consider some of these options if they will save us money, especially if we start looking. I know that Sam had told me on a design build program they could build the high school for something in the neighborhood of $55 to $57 million. That doesn't include the land, but when you add $6 million to that, you're getting up now ABSS is saying that number's hitting closer to $70 million just for the high school, and a lot of that's is involving architects and engineers. I just think we need to take a look at what the options are. We're looking at borrowing a lot of money, not just for that. We're looking at having to borrow money to do what we need to do for the county as well, and we need to look at all our options.
You asked about Falwell, or said it mentioned. I had to call down to the treasurer's office probably three times to get what you're talking about he was going to send us, and I got it.
Well, he told me he was going to send it to me. I talked to Dale.
Well, have you gotten it?
I hadn't gotten it yet.
All right, I've got it, and what it was just a letter, a paper. He said, I mean, what I'm looking at is about eight pages or something from the former county manager of the county that Craig went to. What's the name of that county?
Wayne
County. And so, you know, I mean, I don't care. I'll look at anything, but I know how I feel about all that. But we went down to Chapel Hill one time years ago, talking about architecture. Down at the Friday Center, I think, wherever that is. I can't remember, but I remember we went there.
That's in Chapel Hill.
Yeah, Friday Center. And they were doing a traveling road show across the state on school capital needs, and our region was meeting down there, whatever, or that night. And I was at the table with, I don't know, another commissioner, I think, from here, and David Cheek, county manager, and Bob Etheridge, who was he was a congressman at one time, but I'm not sure what he did prior to that. But anyway, he was sitting at a table in a state treasurer's office, or
legislature, finance, I don't know all the people that were sitting there. And I looked across the table and I said, talking about architects, I said, why don't they just use the same design? You know, over in Greensboro, they built, I think, 5 high schools with the same basic design. Mm-hmm. One I'm at, Southeast Guilford, Northeast Guilford, Ragsdale, at least 4, those 4 right there.
Right.
And then once you got them built, you build around them. You know, you want to change something at your school, you know, they all look different now, but it's because they were all added on to differently. But the basic design was the same architect. And when I said something about architects and along that line, the guy that was sitting at our table, he went, and pointed, I said, he was pointing at another table across the room. I said, what are you doing? He said, those are architectural lobbyists. And so, you know, but I'm not surprised this is going on. The school system told us, that's why I voted against the budget.
Beg your pardon?
This is why I voted against the budget. Harrison sat at a school board meeting and said $100 million. And the school board sat back and said, oh, no, we need to ask for more. And asked for all of it. And they told the state legislature they didn't need but $99 million to bring things up to par just a few years ago. And demographics hadn't changed at all. And we gave them 50 more million. So, you know, that's why I voted against the budget. I said all along it could be done cheaper, and it could have been done cheaper. But we sat back, and the county voted for it, and this board voted for it, 3-2. I think it's ridiculous that they're paying that. I really do. But I don't know what Falwell told you, but he told me he was against all the options.
Yeah, he basically told me he wasn't real happy about the idea. No. But
said he didn't like them. And I'll forward you what he finally sent me. But I had to ask for it 3 times. Not necessarily from him. He called me one morning at 7:30 in the morning. I couldn't believe it was him. And we talked for, you know, 30 minutes at least. And but then I don't know what happened. I didn't get it. So I was determined to get it. So I kept going back through the office, and the person I talked to was on vacation and so forth and so on. But I've got it. I didn't bother to forward it to anybody because I kind of thought it was a dead issue. I'll be glad to send it out.
Well, Mr. Hagan and I have been talking about sort of forecasting, you know, upcoming meetings and what we might be able to do. And I think we were thinking about the meeting in August, one of the August meetings. Somebody from the county staff, there was somebody who was at ACC who did a presentation about the different kinds of funding vehicles for capital building.
I think Ken and Briggs, he's had been the head of the community college system and also is now with the UNC system, I think at UNC Asheville. He did an excellent presentation for the Community College Board of Trustees. He's very knowledgeable about these different these approved methods that the state will allow local governments to use. I thought the presentation he did was very good. So if that's something that the board is interested in, we might could reach out to him and just see you know, if he would be interested in coming perhaps in August.
Sounds like a good idea.
I think it's a good idea.
He's very knowledgeable. He's been through a lot of building processes in public school and community college.
And if he's unable to come, we have that presentation, right? We have the stuff, so maybe we could just have county staff do it, and then if we have questions, then can have a conversation and follow up with that. But that is what we have been envisioning or anticipating.
Right.
I'm not sure there's much we can do about the school board and their decisions.
Yeah, they're probably going to be hiring them pretty soon, aren't they? The firm?
They haven't hired them yet. Last time I talked to them, they hadn't engaged them yet.
They've chosen their architect, but I don't think they've signed the contract.
That's correct.
Yeah. Who is it?
Mosley. And I think the school board has selected the construction manager at risk option this time for the high school and for the Southern High School project.
Right.
But I don't believe that they haven't selected a contractor to actually do the work yet. So I think the point they're at is the committee has approved Mosley as the architect.
Muddy waters.
And then and they've selected the construction manager models.
Mr. Sutton started watching Netflix.
No, I was
was trying to see if I could fix that. That's a long story.
It's time to go.
It is time to go.
Okay, was there anything else we need to talk about? If not, then we'll be adjourned.